Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
Cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
We have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said, empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup. It becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now, water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits and not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you wanna be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
All right, hello everybody, how you doing tonight? Welcome to Comic Book Radio. Thank you for being here. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 193, and tonight my guest is Madison Hawthorne. We're going to be talking about historical fiction and defining indie publishing. What's that all about? What's it like to publish independent comics? I'll be talking with Madison tonight about that. Now, yesterday, YouTube was so weird. Nick Pataro was on the show yesterday, and YouTube was reading like 0 to 2 people in the chat for probably, I'd say, most of the show until the very end. And even though there was, from the estimation of everyone participating in the chat, probably at least 25, 30 people in there, it's telling me right now on Twitter that there's 31 watching and there's 3 watching on YouTube. If you're watching on YouTube, let me know. Say something. Give me a sign of life. We got B-Spin here. What's up, B-Spin? Says, Revengers goes, YouTube be tubing. They're doing something. That's for sure. I don't know if it's corrected. The other day when Dina Martin was on, Twitter was being weird. Twitter didn't want to cooperate. So I don't know what's happening. I don't know if it's a StreamYard issue. StreamYard did have issues a couple days ago, and with posting, just getting a show up and running. I don't know if this is some residual thing from that, but I have no idea. Anyway, I hope you're out there. I hope you're here. I hope you're watching. It's going to be a good show. We got Dr. Mask here. What's up, Doc? Spaceman's here, coming down from above. What's up, Spaceman? Hope you're doing good. Ravindra says, Elon's staff slacking. I don't know if it's a Twitter. I have many problems with the current iteration of Twitter. But I don't know if it was a Twitter issue particularly, as much as it might have been a StreamYard issue or something along those lines. And then the YouTube thing yesterday. Many people were saying they were having problems across the board. Hopefully we don't have any of those problems tonight. Because people couldn't even like the video yesterday. It was strange. Anyway. Doc says, I can hit the like button tonight. So that's something. Well, that's good. That's good. That's an improvement. Cole King, and it was a great conversation yesterday with Nick. If you missed out on that, check up on it after this show or tomorrow, whenever you get around to it. Cole, what's up, Cole? Hope you're doing good. Yeah, Rob Geronimo hit his campaign goal a few hours ago today. Big day today. Big day today for Rob. I think it was like a $500 day or something along those lines. And now he's at like 10,060 something or other, I think. So all of you guys that are out there supporting that campaign, thank you very much for making that happen. And if you're back today, awesome. He's on to like a $12,000 stretch goal now. So we'll see if he gets there. He's going to get there. It's just a matter of time of when. It's a really cool resin statue that he's going to open up as a perk when he gets to that $12,000 mark. So hopefully sooner rather than later. Spaceman, what's up, Spaceman? Says, excellent. Thanks, Pete. Me too. I'm liking it. Yeah, it's good stuff. All right. So I've said hello to you. Time to bring on the man of the hour. Madison Hawthorne is here, so give him a big comic book radio welcome. Mr. Madison Hawthorne, what's up?
Hey, Pete. Thanks for having me on the show. Appreciate it. This is my favorite show, especially what I watch on my regular work day. It passes the time.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, I'm glad to hear that, man. Yeah. I feel like I'm in the presence of royalty with your name, Madison Hawthorne.
It's a good author name for sure. That's
yeah. What you doing writing comic books?
Right.
Don't you know you're supposed to have like a pen name for that and keep your real fancy name for the real stuff?
Right, right.
How did you get involved with comic books, Madison? And I don't just mean as a creator. Let's go back to your first experiences and becoming a reader.
Yeah, I mean, I think I might have mentioned this on the show a couple weeks ago, where like my first actual entry into comic books were like Calvin and Hobbes, comic strips, things like that. And then like the first real comic books that I got was like in the first grade, where I had mentioned like I used to get in trouble in school. So like they called me up to the principal's office and I'm thinking I'm in trouble, but really all they wanted to do was one, they wanted to, because I always read a lot of books from a young age, like kindergarten on up, and I was reading like these, you know, high school level books in first grade, and my principal wanted me to read the books. Read me a book to him, like read me a couple pages from a book. So I wasn't in trouble. So I read a couple pages from the book, and then they had cleaned out this storage closet at the elementary school. And in the back of the storage closet were all these Archie comics. So he just handed me like this stack of like 50 Archie comics that he just gave to me. And so that was kind of my first foray into comic books itself. And then, you know, as a kid, you dabble with, making your own comic book. Like, I think, like I said, I the first comic that I made was maybe two pages of comic book for a character that has no name, but he's like an amalgamation of like, I mentioned, like, it's like Johnny Storm, Meteor Man, and, Dark Man. Right. Because like his origin story is like somehow some plasma from the sun comes down to Earth and hits him, and he gets all like burnt up. So he's like all like toasted up and like ugly. So he's like bandaged up like Dark Man, but he has like Johnny Storm like powers. and so like that's like that was like kind of like my first comics. And you know, like art as a skill was never really my thing. But as a kid, you don't care, right? You're just drawing whatever. It's not about how good it looks or anything like that. It's just fun, right? You're drawing, like for me, I'm drawing Mortal Kombat characters and Ninja Turtles and all those type of things, and putting them in their own scenarios and stuff like that. And that was really kind of the first foray into comics. And then, you know, it just kind of sticks with you. I almost feel like if you're making comics as a kid, you're probably going to end up making comics as an adult at some point in time, you know?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I mean, at least trying and you know,
right.
Dipping your toe into it. What about comics specifically are you drawn to?
You know, comics is like the happy medium between prose and film, right? It's like you can kind of do everything at your own pace, like in prose. But at the same time, you can get the fantastic is delivered to you. You don't necessarily have to make it up in your head like you do in prose. Whereas in the movie, sometimes if you try to take something from a comic book into a movie, it's so fantastic, it doesn't work because it's too real. And on the page, it's real in its own world and it works because it's just so fantastic. It almost can only be done in comics. Like some of these things can only be done in comics to where it's like, if you look at like most superheroes' outfits are ridiculous, but they're so perfect for the page, you know? So it's just like, you know, that's kind of what kind of draws me to comics is just how far you can take it. There's no limit with how far something can happen, what can happen, how it happens in comics. That can, you can almost always, if it's done right, suspend your disbelief and enjoy it because of the way the medium allows you to present the work. That's really what's so great about comic books, you know, as a part to, like I said, versus something like prose or something like film. That's to me is like what's like really always gravitates me towards like reading comics.
Do you think there's any genres that don't work well in comics?
No, not if you do it right. To be honest, because I read a lot of manga. And if you read a lot of manga is all genres, slice of life stuff. There's a manga about a manga creator and how he makes comics and goes through, and it's great. And you would think something like that wouldn't lend itself well to the medium, but you can do it. Cause you know, as long as you have the elements of a story, if you have the elements of the story, the key elements, you can do anything in comics. I don't think there's anything you can't do that wouldn't work in comics. Maybe like, it's been done well. I was going to say maybe something that's like true story, like biography might not work as well, but that's been done and some of them have been done great. So I can't even say that, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. It depends. Some of them not so good and some of them great. And it really depends on how well the medium is being utilized, you know?
Right.
Because comics, like you said, comics can do a lot of things that prose can't and movies can't. You know,
yes.
So it depends. Are you fully utilizing those tools effectively? And it always breaks my heart when I feel like there's people making comics that I don't know if they're aware or maybe they're making an active decision to or not, but it feels like they're not fully taking advantage of everything at their disposal when it comes to making a comic. And they're either, I don't know if they're playing it safe, if they're thinking about an adaptation for film, or maybe if they're not used to the visual storytelling aspect in comics.
Yeah.
But there's always something that I feel like when it misses the mark, that it didn't take it complete advantage of the comic book medium.
I feel like the past like 7 years, I've been seeing that. Like where I feel like it seems like it's people who wanted to make a movie and they take their movie script and they make a comic, but they don't adapt it to the beats that make a comic great. Does that make sense? Like,
yeah.
It's like they just took, they didn't rewrite it as a comic book script. They kept it as a film script and then just did it. Basically, it's like a very detailed storyboard and it's not a comic book. You know what I mean?
Exactly. Yeah, because you can't treat panel to panel the same way you would treat a storyboard getting laid out. You know, they're similar, but comics can do so much more than be cinematic style storyboards, you know, and, right. and you can really effectively incorporate different ways of telling your story successfully that if you just go into it with like a storyboard mindset, you're gonna miss a lot of the different things that you can do with comics.
Yeah, and I've seen enough, I've read books that the artwork is great and the story is there, but it falls flat because it's just missing those comic beats. It's like sometimes I think when someone's taking something from like a film script to a comic, they forget that the action takes place in between the panels, right? Mm. It's almost like all the action happens between the panels, but all the dialogue is happening now in the panel. And you kind of have to have that kind of balance, whereas they want to put all the action kind of in the panels. It doesn't kind of flow right, right? You're seeing things at the end or as they happen, versus, you know, usually it's the beats, right? You kind of put it, you the reader connects the first panel to the second panel. You know what I mean? Does that make sense at all?
Yeah, in a way. I mean, you're kind of talking about what would be, what I define anyway as negative space in writing. You know, negative space visually is easy to see. It's just the part that is not the positive image, which would be what you're drawing. It would be the stuff that's around it that's not being filled in. It's like the notes you don't play. But in writing, right. negative space in writing is all these elements that you leave out instead of filling all of it in and never letting any kind of interactivity happen with the reader. You know, so you're kind of... People call it like ham-fisted writing or heavy-handed writing, that kind of thing. But what you're talking about specifically, I think, is basically you can only take a snapshot in time for every image that you have. And that's that. So you got to utilize, you know, what moment in time is the most effective and appropriate moment.
That's it. Yeah.
To put out there. You know, because there's going to be things you fill in the blanks along the way. You know, if you have a punch going back and then you got one towards the end and you see the follow through, you don't need to have like every single
right.
Six, you know,
a six panel fist coming through,
you know,
full page
six, or you can do fist. One and then show like the lines, the action lines of right. whipping around, you know. So there's all these different kinds of things, and that's just a very, very simple example of all the different kinds of storytelling that takes place within a comic. You know, you don't need to show if a character is here and then the character is elsewhere within a scene, every little thing of how do they get to there. Like that's right. Now you're talking about how animation essentially works. So you right. got to pick right. the moments, and you got to make sure that you're making them dynamic and effective. Even in something that's not an action-based story, it helps to use and play up dynamics and composition. Even if it's a slice of life, change the angles, change the camera, you know, utilize silhouettes, just how you frame things and how you incorporate the lettering, the atmosphere, all that stuff. It goes a long way.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
When you were getting involved with comics, what time frame was that around in terms of when you started?
Like making them or just...
Yeah, like making them and deciding that you were going to make them to sell them.
Probably around 2011.
Okay.
And so it's like I started working on a manga, which I just thought I had a good idea. And really, I kind of got into a point of almost like overconsumption. I had read everything that I liked, almost, you know what I mean? Watched everything that I liked, and you got to a point where, and now it's more and more so, is I'm looking for something that I know will resonate with me. Like sometimes I just know if I'm gonna like it and if I'm not gonna like it. Like, you know, they say, well, how do you know you don't like it if you haven't tried it? Well, because I know I don't like these things, and this is very similar to those things.
Because you've tried so sure. many other
right,
things before.
Right, exactly, yeah. Experience. But it's just one of those things where it's like I'm sometimes looking for something and I can't find it, and so I'm like, why don't I just create it? Because there's got to be other people out there like me who are into this type of story. And obviously the stories get stuck in your head and they kind of come out of your head, right? Like if it's just bugging you for a year, right? Because, you know, like I've always written like just like short stories and things like that. But it's just like I had this good idea for a manga, and I was just like, I'm gonna just make it. And I mean, that's really what I did. Like, you know, real cutting teeth. I put the script on Word. It was terrible. it was terrible. The story's good, but how I was telling the story was terrible, right? So, but you know, I put the script together. I found an artist. I made the whole first issue. And then I sat back and I looked at the first issue and I said, this isn't good enough for me. You know what I mean? Like, I want this to be the quality of the things that I read. So I had to find then a new artist, rewrite the script. You know, usually you want to do this for people who are publishing books. Do this before you put the first issue out. If you're gonna read it. Don't wait till you do the first issue or anything like that and then go back and do it. Trust me, it saves up a lot of time and money. I you know, redid the script, found a new artist, and put together something really solid. And I was like, yeah, this is it. Like, this is what I'm gonna continue to do. You know what I mean? Going forward. And because like growing up, I read manga mostly, and just read a lot of prose. Then I got away from prose and just strictly reading manga. And so the first thing I made was a manga, and it just kind of carried on from there. And my thing is, like, sometimes I have too many stories in my head, you know what I mean? So whatever one is crying for the most attention, right? That's kind of where I kind of do it. It's hard for me. Like, sometimes I got to dial in and do finish this story. Like, you got to, you know what I mean?
Are you working on a series, or are you telling different one and done self-contained stories?
Multiple. So I have a series that's basically right now, Eita, which is like a samurai story. It's 8 issues. It'll be completed by next year. So we're going to have issues 4, 5, and 6 come out this year. 1, 2, and 3 are already out. And then we're gonna have 7 and 8 come out next year. And then I'm also working on a graphic novel. But I think, and that's kind of like a one and done, but it's actually a sequel to another graphic novel, which is all self-contained. You don't really need to read the first one to catch up with the sequel and enjoy it. So like I kind of do that. So like Eita is kind of a limited series. The manga is an ongoing series, so I don't have any definitive end to that, but I just kind of make it as I go. But
are you finding there's anything that readers are drawn to more than others, like some are more successful on that front?
If we're just talking about popularity and things like that, as far as reader response, I call it a graphic novel. It's really like a one shot because it's really not quite long enough to be a graphic novel, but it's called Unicorn Melee. It's like 70 pages. So like, you know, it's kind of like in that weird
range. Long enough to be a graphic novel.
Yeah. It's kind of like in that weird, like, space, but that was definitely been like the one that's resonated the most. It's a fantasy story, obviously unicorns, Unicorn Melee. And that's definitely been the one that's grabbed the most attention. And then Eita has been very popular as well. But the one thing about that that's like surprised me, and I think, and what I heard a lot of, is like I'm looking at the demographics for like the sales, and it's like 45 to 65, right? And I'm trying to figure out, and for a while I was like,
wow, those books sell so good. You're selling 110%. I'm sorry, Madison. I couldn't let you off the hook.
No. I'll talk about the age range.
Okay, I was gonna.
No. That's funny because I didn't clarify. But No. So it's like 45 to 65 age range.
Okay.
And I was trying to like get because I, you know, I'm thinking this is a, it's a 17 plus graphic novel, so it's going to be for adults. But then, as I went to conventions, like I saw, like the one thing that I got from the older people was I really like this comic because I can read it, the font, without struggling. Because I did really like, usually, you know, comics are small font. You know, you're going to go 6 to 8 points, right?
For most horrible comics. Yeah, well, right. I don't go that low, man.
So
I know a lot of but folks, you know what I have.
Right. Right. But this one, I intentionally tried to keep it around 10 for everything. You know, some things I had to squeeze, maybe I do nine and a half. But they were like, cause I can read everything on here. I don't have to like put my readers on. I don't have to, you know, really squint and strain my eyes to read this comic, you know, the everything's just right there. And I was like, oh, that kind of might explain who's buying it and why they're buying it a little bit. Give me some interesting insight. but
yeah, I find that, you know, to your point, I find that especially in the digital age where everyone's working on a screen and you have the ability to zoom in, sometimes there's letterers that they're not going in there and comparing and printing out and doing these things that they should do to something that has been that either they enjoyed or has been previously published and is successful, and look at the sizing and size it up and match it, because there's lettering sometimes on books that I've received as submissions, and even sometimes from creators that I've later signed on, and I have to tell them, I'm like, you got to increase that font size like 3 or 4 points. That thing is tiny.
Yeah. And I think a lot of times it's people trying to make it fit, right? So then they're like, okay, make this fit and we'll just stick with that because I know at this font size I can get what I want to say in. But it's kind of like, and I don't know if you do this, Pete, like with my books, like if I'm doing a script, the dialogue's more for guidance for the artist. It's more kind of, it gives them the sentiment of the character and the ideas. But when the pages come back, that may all, none of it may be the same, you know what? Yeah. I mean, because I have to make it fit and but still tell the story, of course, and say what I want to say. But you know, if it doesn't fit, it doesn't fit. Like I'm not gonna shoehorn it in there with tiny font or just cover up a great piece of art or something, you know, to make the dialogue fit.
Editing is a big deal, definitely, and even the ability to self edit and get rid of some of that stuff sometimes, and that's something that there's a lot of creators out there that they get very precious about these things. And like, I need that. And I'm like, that's superfluous though. You don't need that, you know?
Yeah, it hurts sometimes. Like sometimes you feel like you have a great line that you were gonna put in there on this certain panel. And it's like, it doesn't work. Like, you know, it just gotta go. And then that's tough. And then you wanna go back and be like, I should have probably asked them to give me some more space when I did. When they sent the pencils in or the sketches, but it is what is at that point. Well, you know,
that's the harmony involved with making comics. You got to have that composition that's aware that there's going to be lettering on the page, and you know, sometimes you get back something great and you're like, oh, I don't think I can put any writing on here.
Right, yeah, like where,
even though it needs it. Yeah. But yeah, that's an interesting point when it comes to that. It's something I don't think every step of the way, and that's why I discourage saying that people should edit once everything is done. That's proofreading, you know, like that's all the horses, all the cows, they've left the barn type of thing, you know. And it's like, okay, well, what are you doing now? You got to make sure that instead, every step of the way, there's editing and revision and little tweaking here and there involved, the thumbnails, the pencils, the art, you know, that comes along, and then knowing what that script is going to be like. Nowadays, when I put my scripts together, 90% of the dialogue isn't on there because I know it's not going to be on there by the time I get to it. And I also don't want to deter the artist from really telling the visual story that needs to be there. But when there's moments where it's very important this kind of dialogue is going to be there, I put that in the script. So there's all these different kind of elements that take place, and where comics are a visual medium, you really want to make sure that you're playing up that aspect first and foremost. And if you got to leave some writing off, you got to leave some writing off. Let the art tell the story.
Yeah, it's like you don't taste the food when it's on the plate, right? You taste it when it's in the pot to see if it needs more. You know, it's not when it's ready to go out to the table.
After, you know yeah, I mean? After like you've served it, it's too
right,
late.
After you served it, right, it's too late. Yeah, then it's done. Like, what can you do? But you can maybe edit some dialogue, but
it's in the trash.
The ship sailed.
Yeah, yeah. And that's when it, you know, the heartbreaking stuff comes along, where maybe the artist has to redraw the entire page, or you got to come up with it, or maybe even get rid of the whole page because it doesn't work with the rest of the story. And, you know, you got bigger problems now, but you could avoid a lot of those bigger problems by making the small stuff work along the way. And the editing is a big factor with that. Right. But with your books in particular, now you seem to have a focus on more of like a historical fiction fantasy kind of element. How did that come about?
I think that's more, for the historical fiction, I think it's just part of me kind of like just always being into history in general. You know what I mean? There's something. History is a lot of times romanticized, you know what I mean? Like the people that were living it were just like, it's like they say, everybody thinks it's the end of the times. But when you're looking back at it, like every generation of humans was like, this is it, right? But we're still here. Like, we just keep going. Who knows how we haven't destroyed ourselves yet, but we managed to make it this far. We're trying, we're doing our best. We're doing our best, but
we've been trying for a few thousand years. That's for sure.
Right. But when you look back, it's just like Native American history, Cherokee, Iroquois, you know, Apache, the history it's always appealed to me, you know, samurais, medieval knights, you know, like all of those things like were always like so cool to me. So I always like read a lot of stuff, like prose books on like, you know, Native American stories and medieval, you know, sword and sorcery fantasy books. And then like getting into like reading a lot of manga, a lot of samurai stories. That kind of like gravitated me into kind of like, you know, some you want to tell the things you like, you know, I like these type of stories, I'm going to tell kind of this type of story. So then you kind of get into the historical fiction aspect of it. So like something like Eita, which is set in feudal Japan, right at the cusp of, and it's interesting because I feel like the past, I feel like since I put this book out, it's like samurais have been on the uptick. As far as in the media, like just video games, you know, they FX dropped the Shogun show. You know, all these things are coming out. But
you're a trendsetter, Madison.
Yeah, I did it. It's all me. Yes. No, but it's just weird how things converge kind of like that. Or it might just be like, you know, when you buy a car and now you see your car all the time. It could just be that too. You know what I mean? It could just be one of those things. I made something and now I'm just seeing this everywhere now. But it's like one of those things where you're kind of just interested in. So you kind of get into kind of telling those type of stories. But it's like when you're doing historical fiction, especially if it's like a culture that it's not your culture, right? So it's like, it's one of those things where you want to be kind of true to the story, but it's like it's fiction still at the end of the day, right? So it's like I've seen people do like historical fiction, but it's so heavy on the historical, it doesn't really work because it's almost like a history piece, you know what I mean? Like the story's lost because it's so focused on just being so accurate and dialed in, and then it's like, well, but where's the story? Like, yeah, they used this certain type of spoon in 1700, and you got that right. But where's the story, you know?
Yeah, yeah. You're creating fiction with one hand tied behind your back kind of thing.
Right. So it's just like...
Now, you bring up a good point. There's a lot of stuff nowadays in terms of what's going on with people and creating stories. And especially when anyone starts to create a story that's outside of their culture or their heritage or their gender or their anything nowadays, they're picking apart everything sometimes. Sometimes it seems like everything is under fire depending on who it is or what the topic is. What are your thoughts on that in terms of that kind of thing being scrutinized the way it is?
I think it's a bit overblown nowadays, but I think that's just part of how things are going now. Everything's a bit overblown. I mean, as a creator, if you have a story to tell, doesn't, you know, you tell the story, right? It's like as an actor, you know, you can't play a certain role, but it, I mean, you're an actor. You're literally never playing yourself. So like, like that's your job. So like, I mean, I think anybody can write anything, right? It's as long as it's good. If it's good, it's good. You know what I mean? But I guess to the essence, it's like, you shouldn't be writing it to try to be that, because you're not that. Does that make sense? It's like, you gotta let things be what they are. So like me, if I'm writing a historical fiction samurai story, you know, I'm not Japanese, so, but I'm not trying to write it like I'm a Japanese person. You know what I mean? I'm writing it for who I am, you know, and how I came up, based off the things I know about their history and the things that I've enjoyed and read. And then it rings true, right? It's almost like, it's almost like something like, I guess an example would be like, it's like reggae, right? So it's Jamaicans trying to do rock and roll and R&B, but they're being true to themselves. It's never gonna be rock and roll and R&B, but what does it do? It becomes reggae, something great. You know what I mean? That's kind of how, like a lot of things kind of permeate and become what they are. Like I read a lot of manga that try to emulate the Marvel DC capes and tights. It'll never be that, but it becomes its own great thing because they're being true to just trying to tell a great story, knowing that that's the influence and the makeup of it. So that's kind of like where it is. It's like, I think people go wrong when they try to be that. And it's like, you don't have to be that. You just have to tell a good story and be true to what you're writing.
Yeah, and I think that's the paradox, because so many people are unknowingly, or maybe knowingly, I don't know, advocating for you to emulate. So if you don't, like the whole adage of write what you know, that sort of thing. You know, it's kind of mutated into this grotesque modern adage of write what you are. And now you're really putting yourself in a box.
Right.
You're
gonna then you write, can't tell any stuff.
Only, yeah, all you can do then is do autobiography. You know, right. So if you're just not making an autobiography, all of a sudden it turns into a very controversial story. You know, well, what do you mean by that character is this way, or that character looks that way, or this character is the villain, this character is the hero? All of a sudden, it's a moral referendum on every single thing in your story, and it comes back to you. And why did you decide to make that way?
Right.
You know, and so it really could become this creatively suffocating experience. And to me, I'm just... You want to make a story? Make a story. People like it, they like it. They don't like it, they don't like it. You know, yeah. And if you don't like that kind of story that's out there, or you don't like however that was done, come up with your own. Or find ones that you do like, because I guarantee there's a bunch of them that you like. Even if they're not right now being made, I guarantee you can still dive deep into the millions of things that have come before this recent story you're not enjoying, and discover something you do enjoy. Right. So if you're a creative person, though, especially, I hate when I see creative people advocating for the censorship of other creative people based on something they thought they did that was inappropriate within the context of whatever story it is. It's just, if that's the frame of reference I think we want to view everything through, if that's the critical lens that we're going to start analyzing everything, man, that is one hell of a live by the sword, die by the sword kind of thing.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's just, I mean, like, to your point, it's like, it's not, that's not saying like, go out and, if you're going to do like historical fiction, go out and write about something you completely ignorant about, right?
Exactly.
Like yeah, you've never read anything about it. You don't know. I'm just going to do it. Well, now you're going to, yes. There's still some work to be done, right? Yeah. Like you still have to educate yourself to a degree so that you can tell a good story. You know, that's really what it's about. If like generally, I would say that generally I've never seen anyone be offended by something that's a great story. But nowadays, I don't know if that's true. But
I don't know. Yeah,
three years ago, or 4 years ago, that might have been true. But generally, if you're telling a great story.
You know, truth be told, I think we've always had this kind of mindset among some people. But I think like anything, the internet, social media, whatever it may be, you know, whatever you want to call the entertainment media, that kind of thing too. I think it feels anyway like it is omnipresent. So because of that false kind of feeling, it feels, I think, for a lot of us that, you know, oh, 10,000 people on Twitter said something. Well, if you think about it in the scope of, I mean, and that seems like it's a lot, right? But then if you think about it in the scope of, that's a whole other thing. You know, you think about it in the scope of the entire planet or the entire audience that you could potentially have for this sort of thing. 10,000 people is probably not even 0.0001%.
Right.
Is what, you know, so
not many people.
So many things get blown completely out of proportion, and the vocal. It's even difficult to say the vocal minority at that point because it's such a small amount percentage wise, compared to the people who aren't saying anything or don't really care about that, and you know it doesn't really matter to them. It feels like you're being cornered, and it's so important when it comes to certain things to just not cave into that. But yeah, research, if you're doing historical fiction, research is obviously very, very important. I mean, I've seen things though that research was, I don't know if they even did any.
That's
another story. But you know, when someone's creating something that's purely fictional, you know, especially if it doesn't even take place on Earth,
right?
And you know, it becomes very difficult at that point, unless you're talking about it's been made. There's been rules and parameters established and what's been made, and then those things should be followed to have continuity and things that exist on this world, this character, this, you know, now you're talking about consistency, and that's a different thing. But no matter what, even if it's the worst thing ever, I don't advocate for that thing to be censored or silenced or whatever. You know, it's horrible. Well, then why do you care? It's going to live and die and be gone within moments. Because something better is going to immediately come along. Because how could it not? That thing is so bad. Something better will absolutely come along.
Right. I mean, yeah. Or you give it life. You complained about it so much, you gave it more life. You keep breathing life into it because you keep, you know what I mean? Candyman three times and he shows up. So, you know what I mean? Don't say your name.
Yeah. The you know... The apathy and silence will get things canceled. Will kill things off quicker than the vocal, you know, everyone that they're getting outraged by it or calling it out or whatever it may be. Especially nowadays where corporations see attention is, you know, any attention is good attention. And it'll take it away from something else, which could be amazing. But isn't getting any of the attention because this thing was so bad and infuriated so many people that it just sucked the oxygen right out of the room, you know. But if no one said a word about that horrible thing and no one cared and spread the word and, you know, became the promotional arm of it, it would die out quick.
Yeah. And I think that's the hard part, though, for us as humans, right? Because when things go well or they're good, that's what was supposed to happen. So I'm not going to say anything. But when you don't like something, then it shouldn't have went that way. So I'm going to say something, or you know what I mean? Instead of like, we really like as people, don't spend enough time pushing and speaking about the things we really enjoy. You know what I mean? Publicly. You know what I mean? Yeah, most people, absolutely. Like, especially now on social media, most people, they're talking about things they don't really like a lot of times. And it's like, talk more about the things you do like. You know what I mean? But we kind of fall into that, like...
It's a human nature thing. I think we tend to vent and, you know, we get it off our chest. And the things that bring us joy a lot of the time, I think sometimes we take them for granted until they're gone. And then we vent about them being gone. And we didn't know what we had when we had it, you know. And it's, and I'm guilty of doing that from time to time as well. I'm trying not to do as much of it anymore. And I'm not saying that if something comes along and you're not into it, don't talk about it. Or if something comes along and it's bad, don't say anything. But there's a difference, I think, between almost like the obsession about it. You know, like, let's say if you don't like something that came out 5 or 6 years ago and you're still talking about it today and you've been talking about it every day for 5 or 6 years, that's not healthy. You gotta move on at some point.
Right.
You know, so that's it's that part of it. But if something comes out and you're like, oh no, I don't really like that, that's not that great, you know, then okay. You know, that's just expressing how you feel, and that should be encouraged. But it's a shame when I think we see a lot of people get kind of sucked into the obsessive mindset of the thing is bad, you know. We agreed 5 years ago. Many of us have moved on now to some better things, some maybe worse or just the same. But, you know, it's good to be able to move on and keep the conversation going. Because I think if we don't, that's when it gets really weird. You know, when the conversation dies out. And I've talked about this before, but let's say in comic books, if we were to stop talking about comic books because, you know, for whatever reason, well, then no one's going to know they exist. If you don't talk about what you're making, no one's going to know you're making anything.
Yeah.
So the conversation's important.
Yeah, that's, I mean, especially for indie creators, right? Because it's like, if you can have the greatest comic in the world. That's like I always use, like what I always say is, you could open a restaurant and have the best food in the world, but if you don't do any advertising, you're going to close down. Like, it doesn't matter how great the food is on the inside if nobody even is coming through the door because they don't know you exist. And so it's like for indie creators, you definitely got to promote your stuff. Like, you know, however you got to do it, you can't, it's not a industry or a place where you can just make something great and expect people to come find you. You know what I mean? It very rarely does that happen, especially if you're unknown. You know what I mean? If you're just coming, if you're showing up to the party with all your own supplies, you know what I mean? Nobody invited you to the party or anything like that. You got to go out and you got to start introducing yourself to people essentially at that party. You know what I mean? Like, that's just how it is for indie creators. You gotta kind of put yourself out there. I think Jim Zub said it best, because when I was first getting into comics, you know, I'm trying to figure out how to do things and things like that. And one of the things he said, so as an artist came up to him and was showing him his portfolio, and he's like, you know, the portfolio is pretty good. And he was like, well, like, I mean, how good are you with like talking to people and networking? And he's like, not very good. He was like, get good at it. You know what I mean? I don't want to see you again until you get good at that, because that's in essence, you know, teaching you and really how to market yourself.
Yeah, communication. I mean, that's just a vital tool even in life, you know? Yeah. And if even all the things that you just said are important in life, and they play out within whatever path you choose career-wise or anything else. But yeah, if your communication skills as far as wanting to talk or express yourself or, you know, just tell people what it is that you're even doing, that's a big mountain to climb. And that really is, that's good advice that he gave, because it's important. And that's why I encourage, even when people get down on themselves about stuff like YouTube or whatever it is, you know, we all start off and it's some are better at it than others, and some get better at it than others do. But I think everyone that starts, let's say if you keep doing it for a year, 2 years, 3 years, you look back at where you were, you know, you're gonna develop a lot of different skills that were vital that maybe you just developed over time, because that's just how it is. But if you never did it, if you never did it, you never started. You're that much further behind.
You just gotta kind of, especially, I mean, like you said, like for like YouTube, even myself, like I would love to just be the guy who writes comics and sits back and nobody knows what I look like, and I'm selling a trillion books, and I'm just, you know what I mean? Like, I'd love to be that anonymous person. but you can't, like, I can't be that person. Not yet. Maybe one day. Yeah. Maybe one day. But
man, what I love is stories like that, when people say, well, you know, so-and-so, and then, you know, now everyone knows them. I'm like, did you ever look into their life?
Right.
You ever look into the life of that artist you just talked about, who died broke, penniless, and starving, and didn't make a dime during their life on their art? And then later on, someone came along, or the author who came along and was like a recluse, and the only reason that anything ever sold was because they pretty much gave away all their rights to the publishing company or the publisher or whoever it might have been. Right. You know, it's not like these stories of... I mean, if anything, isn't that the trope generally, is the starving artist, and then they went unrecognized, and you know, and then 20 years later, all of a sudden now a painting they couldn't sell for $5 is going for $1 million.
Right.
You know, but they're dead. They're gone. They suffered. They didn't get any enjoyment out of that $1 million that painting or whatever is now worth. Yeah,
they died broke.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's part of it. Like, even like my wife will say, like, my wife would be like, I noticed you've been writing scripts for 2 weeks. You got to put your business hat on. You know what I mean? You got to go put your business hat on. You can't just sit down and write and not go promote things. Like, you know what I mean? It's like, she'll remind me, hey, you got to put that business hat on. I know it's not your favorite thing to do, but you know, that's, it's just part of, it's part of the game. It's, you know, that's it. And it's good, because like I said, if you really are making stories for the enjoyment of others, you gotta show them where to get it.
Yeah, you gotta interact with those people. You gotta let them know. Yeah. If it's just for you, when your refrigerator or your mom or your dad or your spouse or your kids or whatever, you know, then hey, whatever. But if it's, no, this is for other people to get and enjoy and purchase and all these other things, and you know, the more of them that purchase it, the more I can do these other things I want to do. Well, okay, well, if that's part of the equation, then you got to start talking to those other people. You got to start getting out there and letting them know that you exist. Hey, what's up, Spicer? Thank you for being here. We're having a good conversation tonight. I'm here with Madison Hawthorne from Golden Tree Publishing. So what's been the most difficult aspect of indie comics publishing for you? Something that you really didn't foresee that you would have to learn?
Honestly, I kind of came into it knowing that I had to learn a lot of stuff. But so when I came in, when I first got into comics, I was really focused on distribution. Like, where am I going to get my books at? And just like, you know, learning about that whole process, never really went the diamond route, because I looked into it and like, for me, it didn't seem like it was very much worthwhile. And then obviously, the Wide Sage, Pete Sametti, had some things to say about that Diamond Comics that kind of confirmed what I was thinking anyway, when I was kind of like staying away from them. But just learning how to kind of market and promote, and on the business side, learning kind of some of the margins, right? So it's like, I sent a bunch of stuff into Amazon and they're taking their split. I'm getting my split. but how they're doing the reorders, I'm like, you know, I'm losing, you know, on 100 books, I'm losing $3. This is not going to work, right? You know what I mean? Like if I sell 100 books, negative $3, you know what I mean? Total. And so it's like, okay, that, like, you know, the curve on how I'm going to get books out to readers. And then just the whole hurdle of, like, you create your own website, trying to drive traffic to your own site. That's like the biggest hurdle. Because it's kind of a website out there in the ether. And so, like, you know, still learning, man, still cutting my teeth on a lot of things, but definitely on the distribution side. And the other thing I learned too is, like, just as an indie creator, so you get your books, say, like, on consignment, local shops. So, like, you know, usually you can touch like 10, 12, 13 shops within your range, and that, you know, you can check on those books and check the inventory. But, you know, you kind of have to, and it's weird because, like, when I first started, the consignment I'm giving, they're getting a way better percentage from me than they're getting from Diamond. You know what I mean? From Marvel and DC and these guys. But when I go, like, I noticed, like, 4 or 5 shop owners would call me and say, hey, you know, your books are sold out, come get your checks. Or I'd call and say, hey, what are my books, you know, how are the books doing, or something like that. Oh, they're doing good, you know, come get your split, whatever. Then I call, you know, the other 7, and they're like, oh no, you haven't sold anything. I'm not going to the store, you know, after 6-7 months, right? I haven't sold anything. I'm like, I'm gonna leave the books there, right? They're in the back of the store. You know what I mean? Like, nobody, and I noticed that all the places where I was selling them, they were in the front of the store on good shelf space. And the ones I weren't were just buried back there somewhere. So it's, yeah, like, you know, like, what are you guys doing? Like, you know what I mean? Like put these in the front. Like, these are selling at these other stores. Like, put these in the front of the store. And a lot of them wouldn't do it. So it's just like, yo, give me my books back, man. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
That kind of thing always amazes me when it's a local shop, especially, because I think all local shops, if I had my local comic shop, if I owned one, I would have a local creator section, and it would be very easy to stock, because all you got to do once, twice a year, maybe even, is just when you're at a convention or go to a convention, go to the artist alley. And just get some books and say, I have this shop, you know, could I get some off your hands at 50%? You know, get 2-3 copies from 20-30 people. Maybe spend $200-$300 on that. You would have sold far more if you were tabling at that or whatever it might have been. But you can have this local creator section. Maybe even invite some of them to do a signing. Maybe then get some books. And I've done signings too, where some of the retailers were great about it and they got some books off my hands for afterwards. But very few, I think only 1 or 2 stores I've ever been at out of like the 30, 40 shops I've done signings at have had a local creator section. And that's right. Such an important thing. You know, you're a smaller store. You're not a big, huge, you know, big box kind of corporate store. So if you want to utilize the local angle, you know, local comic shop, embrace that aspect of it with your community, and especially with the community of creators that are around. That's so important. Right. And I find that there's just a ton of comic shops out there that aren't doing anything like that. You know, so like when they're getting your books in there and they're putting them to the back, that should be on the register, on like a little countertop display sort of thing.
Right. Right. Especially if you're getting a better split, even. Like,
yeah.
Even yeah, that's just interesting. Like, especially like when I had first released Unicorn Melee, which was like the graphic novel that I had mentioned, and that was selling like really well. Like it did really well for me. And the stores where it wasn't selling, they like, because it was a graphic novel, but it wasn't fat enough for me to have the marquee on the spine. So there's no indication on the spine of the book.
So that's weird. You said it was like a 70 pager?
It was like a 70 page, but the printer I was using couldn't put the...
Oh, wow. That's weird.
So when they would put it in a shelf, now it's gone forever. Like at that, it's like the box, it's like the Ark of the Covenant, Indiana Jones. It's just in there. You know what I mean? Good luck. Like,
was it perfect bound? It had a spine?
Yeah. Yeah. But I think it was like 0.3 inches too small for them to get anything on the spine. You know, I could have threw some junk pages in there, but you know, this, I feel like it wouldn't have done justice to the book, you know, if just to have some filler. And, you know, I'm not in a space where I'm selling an advertisement or anything like that.
Yeah. Well, I mean, book, that's, that's a big problem with the book industry in and of itself, is there's so much product, and most of it is never going to be face out, cover out. Even when you get into distribution, you have to pay for that. Anytime you walk into like a Barnes and Noble or any other kind of bookstore, not comic shops, I'm surprised they haven't utilized some kind of pay to play sort of mentality at this point. But if you go to Barnes and Noble and you see any book that's face out, it's either one of two things: either they paid for that or a customer did that,
right?
Because they're never supposed to be face out unless they got paid to be faced out with the cover out, which is funny because of the fact that, you know, there's so much that goes into the covers, and then meanwhile all you really ever see is the spines. All over the place,
right?
It should almost have like a rotation, you know, and I know maybe that would be a big pain in the you know what, but like it would help probably move more product. So I think the pain would be worth it, because if you had like a rotation of facing out, you know, even if they didn't pay for the thing, you know, if they paid for it, it's always faced out. But even then, if you pay for it, someone could come along, a customer picks it up, looks at it, and then they put its spine back and they stuff it into wherever. So it's a weird thing.
I guess they feel like it takes away from basically inventory, right? If everything's the width going width wise, right?
They have less books, exactly. But, yeah, because there's so much product. There's only so much space to house the product, but at the same time, I think there's always at least like, you know, a lot of shops at least will have their new release wall and they'll have things face out for at least that moment, that week in time. I know some shops, it's, you know, the new release wall is, it's frightening. There's a shop by me I'm thinking of particularly where they have their new release wall, but all they do is put the new release on top of all the previous old releases in the series. So you'll see like a stack of like practically destroyed looking comics behind it. And here's the newest soon-to-be-destroyed comic on the front.
Right.
And it's like bulging out of the rack, and it's folded, and the cover stock. And then, the publishers don't use a cover stock that's appropriate a lot of the time. So you'll see what I call the sleepy comic effect, where like they're kind of caving on each other when they're standing there. So it's damaged. It's DOA, these comics.
Right.
And it drives me crazy. I don't know why, between the publishers and the shops, why they don't get like have a dedicated spot that's just for that, and then have the other stuff elsewhere. And Lord, I can't stand the idea of seeing the books, because everyone's like, get your books back into shops again, get them. I'm like, for what? So they could be destroyed and just sit there, and then, you know, they languish, and then they go into the 50-cent dollar bin or whatever it may be, and where they get lost again for Lord knows how long. Right, I'd rather just do this direct, goes right to the reader, and, you know, they're enjoying it.
Yeah. It's definitely a lot less cumbersome if you can go direct. You know, at least you don't have to worry about those type of things. You don't have to worry about where they're putting your books.
Oh, yeah, you're putting your business in someone else's hands. That's always a nerve-wracking experience.
Yeah, it's like, are they even giving you a fair chance to, you know what I mean, to get a shot at it? And some of it is like, especially if something's selling, like I said, my experience when I was first getting started, you know, is like, you know, now I ask specifically if I can put it somewhere. You know, like I'll have like five or six, I'll look at the store and say, can it go in one of these locations? And if they can't, then I'm just not going to do it. You know what I mean? Because and since most of my sales are basically through like my own website now and like Amazon, I'm not like, you know, consignment is not a concern of mine, but just saying like for anyone getting started out there, because you want to get your books out there and things like that, you know, you don't be discouraged if like your book isn't selling at a comic shop, especially if they just put it like somewhere random and like the back, because it's like people aren't even finding it. And nobody even probably got a chance to really even look at it. You know, they put it on the top shelf in the very back corner, you know, and it's partly obscured by G.I. Joe collectible action figure. You know,
I mean, you sound like you're talking from experience.
right.
It's a very specific reference.
It's very, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, right. But it's like that book's probably not going to sell. It doesn't matter what book's in that spot. You know, it could be the newest Spider-Man comic, and people aren't going to see it through the sea of everything else that's going on.
Well, I mean, to be perfectly honest, too, I've talked about this before, but you know, you go into a comic shop, everything there is for sale. You know, so if a comic shop is stacked to the gills with books in boxes and boxes and on the shelves, just there are tons of them. Like I talked about the Sleepy Comics, because there's so many comics and there's just been sitting there and they're getting piles and piles and piles added on more and more and more. Not only are your books not selling, those books aren't selling either.
They're right.
You know, it shouldn't, because some people go, oh, it should be great. It's my dream to get my book in a comic shop. My dream is to get it in the hands of someone who's enjoying it and reading it and loving it. My dream has had nothing to do with the comic shop, was just kind of like a pit stop,
right? You know, so it means to the end.
Yeah. Too many creators I've met along the ways where that was the dream. That was the goal, to get it in a comic shop. Wouldn't that be great? And then once it was in the shop, it was like the book didn't exist anymore. They never talked about it again. They wouldn't mention it. They wouldn't care. It was just like, okay, I dropped my kid off to over here and see ya, you know?
Well, I mean, if that's their dream, they lived it out. Like, they, you know, they lived it.
But then meanwhile, yeah, that book goes there, goes to the shop, and then that's it. It's there.
That's it.
With, you know, it's like a comic graveyard as opposed to a comic shop. And it's unfortunate, because it really shouldn't be that way. But that's, to go back to an earlier point you had made about, you know, sustaining your career and doing all these other things, and that you have to get the word out. There's not one, not even the big companies are self-sustaining. Not even the biggest character is self-sustaining.
Right.
You know, and you can go to any store anywhere, and there's a testament to that. There's always going to be something of either that character or that comic or whatever it may be, that's still there, that someone isn't coming in and picking up, and whether they know about it or not or whatever it may be. So if they could have a tough time with 70 years or whatever it might be of existence, and these kinds of bigger companies that seem like, oh, who wouldn't know them? Then obviously, you know, you got your work cut out for you. So I never understood that mindset of not thinking that, you know, all the work and effort that you go into putting and creating the comic, and then you give the whole, okay, it's out now, and then you disappear. You know, you gave like this tiny fraction of a second to promoting and letting people know about it. You know, so I look at that and I go, why'd you put those however many hours it took you to get to that point to create that book if you were just going to give just a tiny fraction of that to letting people know that you made it?
Yeah, and there's no expiration date on promoting your book. Like, not like, especially like, I feel like, you know, maybe like it's Marvel and DC, so like, I don't know, they don't want to promote the Spider-Man that they did 10 years ago because they've got, you know, 15 new ones coming out, so they're going to push those. But for indie creators like myself, I'm pushing Samurai Tale number one all the time, because you know what I mean, because there's so many people that haven't heard of it yet. It's new to them, it's brand new to them.
Yeah
so it's hitting them the same way it hit the first people I reached out to when it was first created. It's not one of those things where you're gonna oversaturate yourself, you know, if you're kind of indie publisher, and it's all yours, right? Like, it's, these are all your books. It's going to be new to somebody. You shouldn't stop promoting something just because it's out now. It's out now, I'm done promoting it. But you got to keep promoting it. Like, you can't stop. You know, like Unicorn Melee. I still promote that. And even though we're working on the sequel now, but I still promote that. You know, that came out 5-6 years ago. It's going to be new to somebody.
And some people hate that aspect of it, of the promoting and the marketing and what to me, that's the fun part. The work is creating it, getting it together, and that's fun too. But afterwards is the fun part of you're getting now to share what you've created. You're getting to put that now into the world and share it with people out there. And if you can't get in that mindset that's fun, that's right. That's great. That's the rewarding part. You know, you get it out there, someone picks it up, they enjoy it, they let you know about it. That's what made everything else worth it.
Right.
But you only get there if you're actually talking about your book and what you've made. I've got two questions here in the chat for you. Oh, did you want to answer?
Oh, no, go
follow
ahead,
up
go
with
ahead.
That?
Oh, yeah, sure? I was just going to say that it's, you got to kind of, actually, I almost lost my thought there. What was the last thing you said? You're good. You're
just
good.
About, you got to, you know, get the word out there when it comes to right. making your stuff. And yeah.
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, everybody should enjoy talking about their own story. That, you know what I mean? Like, at the very least, like, even if you don't enjoy promotion, you're uncomfortable, you're an introvert. I'm an introvert. You know what I mean? Like I don't necessarily, I'm not, I put the hat on for promotion, but I definitely enjoy talking about my stories. Like, you know what I mean? Like, cause they're exciting to me. So like nobody, like at the very least, you can do that. You can get excited about your own story. Cause if you're not excited for it, who else is gonna be excited for it?
Absolutely. Okay, so here's some questions for you. Comics for Life says, do you sell in European countries like France or Spain where historical stories seem to be more acknowledged or accepted?
So I don't do international shipping. But I do digital for almost all my books. So anybody can go on my website and get the digital version. So of like Eitai, The Samurai Tale, Unicorn Melee, and some of the other titles that I have on my website at goldentreepublishing.com. You can get any of the digitals, and that's, you know, anybody can get those.
All right. You said goldentreepublishing.com?
Yes.
Let me put that in here for you. I've got the link for the sign up to your Unicorn Melee 2. I've got that in the description of the show. I'm going to put this one in after the show ends. So goldentreepublishing.com, you guys can click on that and go check it out. Comics for Life asks again, do you think the mass production of variant covers and tie-in titles by the big companies has made it difficult to find indie books?
In the shop? If you mean in the comic shop, absolutely. But that's the whole point. They're trying to flood the shelf space. That, you know what I mean? Like that's what Marvel and DC are trying to do. It's like Coke and Pepsi on the end caps. You know what I mean? They're trying to flood the shelf space. They don't want any type of competitors, and they want the comic book shops to kind of depend on them. So yeah, absolutely. Those variant covers and things like that, that's part of it. There's not supposed to be 10 Superman issues 3 weeks after it came out, still on the shelf. That's not how it's supposed to work. Those were supposed to sell. But but as long as they keep the shelf space, right? And that goes back to what I said about like them putting like my book in the back or any comic book in the back. It's because the rest of the shelf space is flooded and they don't want to necessarily give that shelf space up to an unknown. They want to give it to, you know, they spend all this money on these books. They got to put them on the shelf and kind of hope they sell. So yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I think that it makes it difficult to find any books in the comic shop.
And it takes a really visionary, intrepid retailer to go, you know what? I'm going to order what I know I'm going to be able to sell from these companies. that book in particular there, I don't think I'm going to be able to sell that. I'm not going to order that. I don't care what company made that. I don't care what character that is. If someone wants to order it on their pull list, that's fine, but I'm not putting any on the shelf. Most retailers I've talked to, when I'm like, why wouldn't you give this a chance? You think this looks good. You even said this one here looks better than what is coming out from this one at this more well-known publisher or has a more well-known character. And they go, well, because if I don't have that one, I might miss out on that sale. Whereas right. this other book, maybe no one knows of it. So it's more likely to not ever have sold. If you have that constant, if you're a retailer with that constant fear of missing out thing, you know, a lot of them get sucked into the variant scheme because of that. A lot of them get stuck with a lot of books that you could, almost anyone could look at and go, you don't need 25 copies of that book. I could see maybe two, three, four, you know, but 25, what are you doing? I know one retailer in particular, you go down to their basement. I was doing this one time at a sign. I was going to the bathroom and their basement is in the bathroom's in the basement. And in the basement, I don't, maybe a million comics, man. It's a big store and the entirety of the store has a basement. And I've never seen maybe at least 2,000-3,000 long boxes full. You know, two of them were full of one title from one issue from one specific, and it came out 3 months ago from one of the bigger publishers.
They bet the farm on that book.
And I was like, so when I got up, I was like, what's up with the basement? You know, and he goes, oh, those are the books we bring out to the shows when we go to like conventions and stuff. And I'm like, oh my Lord. Like, I can't imagine you take those all out of the bay. You have a store, you know, like, why don't you just let people come down and do that thing? But to see that many, it's just sitting there from a, it came out 3 months ago, you know, it boggled my mind. If it's not selling, it's losing money. You know, so it drives me nuts when I've had books at Alterna. Where I'm like, okay, you know, I give like a year or two for this amount that we printed and it should sell. And then if it's still there in 3 years, I'm like, what is going on with this book?
Right.
You know, it's so, you know, and that's as a publisher with inventory. I can't imagine being a retailer and you go that big on, you didn't need to, you know, and you do time and time and time again. It's very, very, very strange,
it's very insane, Pete. Just
Comics for Life, that's totally a problem that's occurred, but it's very similar to what occurred in the 90s. You know, they go, the collector bubble burst. No, it's the publisher gimmick bubble burst, and it was at the fault of not just mostly the publishers what they were doing, but also. A lot of the retailers were just in there. They had no idea what they were doing, many of them. And they were just in there because comics, well, all of a sudden, it became a hot collectible. They go in there. The publishers took advantage of that. The retailers took advantage of that. And eventually, by the time everything slowed down and the customer became wise to what was occurring, a lot of it was too late because it all got compounded. And then the distribution system that occurred got that as various ones started shutting off. Because of the way that went, that situation became this like bottleneck for all those publishers that were desperate to sign a deal to cling on to exclusivity with what they thought would be the last sole surviving distributor that didn't want to deal with returnable terms, and that was Diamond. So all of this stuff that happened, it went from like this really healthy industry to all of a sudden, you know, the publishers smell blood in the water. Everything's a collectible, collector's item, every single thing, you know, and an unsuspecting public bought into it. But it wasn't because the collector should be blamed or the customer should be blamed. If anything, it shows how much our industry hasn't learned that much at all by still calling it something like that. It was a gimmick bubble from the publishers. Right.
It's a gimmick, exactly. And by doing that, too, you place the value on the gimmick and not on the stories being told. You know what I mean? So it's like, it's no longer about the stories being told. It's about having this thing to hold.
Absolutely.
But yeah. Not to be spoken about. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And it's fun to do something fun or commemorative or gimmicky every now and then. I definitely had a couple of the glow-in-the-dark covers and the hologram covers and whatnot.
Right.
But, man, the gimmicks of now would make, like, the 90s gimmick blush.
Yeah.
But, yeah, there's definitely a limit to that oversaturation aspect. One question I want to ask you before we wrap things up, probably about 10 minutes or so we'll wrap things up. When you're creating and getting involved with your creative teams and you're coordinating all of that, how do you go about that? Are you fielding submissions? Are you hiring people? And if you are hiring people, what are you looking for in terms of who you want to work with or who you want to assign onto a book and work with them to create what you're creating?
Yeah, we could do a whole show on that, Pete. to put it short, multiple ways. I mean, now, because I've kind of been doing it a while, it's referrals mostly. But I'll give you an example, especially for anybody watching this that's an artist trying to get work. Don't be scared to be an artist who's trying to get work, too, because I do say, like, a lot of times, you know, every artist wants to do their own story. You know, it's sometimes it's good to team up with a writer. You know what I mean? And you guys can create some magic together. It doesn't always have to be your own thing. But it runs the gamut. A lot of times it's referrals. Now, like, I'll reach out. Like, actually, I think you had Andy Smith on here a while ago, and Andy Smith has given me some great referrals for artists. But I've nice. I've also reached out and solicited artists. Like when I first started doing ATA, I found the artist Ozzy Longoria on Pencil Jack, which is an old comics forum. And you know, at that point in time, I'm scouring the internet because I gotta find the artist that fits the story I'm trying to tell. And so, like, ironically enough, it's one of those things where, so like, Unicorn Melee 2, which I believe, Pete, you said had the link for the pre-sign up for the Kickstarter.
Yep.
So that was an artist who had reached out to me to do as part of a submission when I was looking for the artist to do ATA, and I went with Ozzy. But he was the second runner up. But I felt like his style really didn't fit what I was trying to do with ATA. But he comes back to me 5-6 years later, saying, hey, you know, I'm open for work. You know, I had submitted you before. And so, you know, do you have anything? And so I was in the process of putting the script together for Unicorn Melee 2. I already knew his artwork, but usually I'll have him do a sample page or something like that, right? Because I need to see exactly, you can do exactly what I want. So, you know, I'll send him a page of the script and say, you know, do this. But one, and the reason why I mentioned this one is one, because like as an artist, he showed me, right? He sent me a submission. He put together a quality thing 5-6 years ago. He's still doing it 6 years later. You know, like, you know what I mean? He didn't fall off at any point in time. He's still doing, he's still looking for work. He's still active, right? And then I know he's talented as well. So then it's like, okay, yes, now I do have a project. So like it's kind of a mix, because now it's like, it's mostly referral, but now that I've touched base with so many artists, sometimes they're reaching out to me saying, do you have anything? You know, here's my portfolio. But you know, in general, like I said, it's mostly referral now, or people sending me stuff saying, do you have any work? Which, you know, me, I can only do 2 projects at a time max. So, you know, like right now, that's it. Like I can't work with any other artists. And usually when those projects are done, to be honest, at this point, because I'm happy with the artists I work with, they'll probably work on the next projects if they're available. You know what I mean? So that's just kind of how it goes. But I say that just for artists to say, like, yo, don't quit because you aren't finding work. Keep working, you know, working on things and doing, then keep reaching out, because a lot of artists, you know, don't show that kind of dedication. So you can't just be doing art when you actually are getting paid for it, right? If you're an artist, you're doing it anyway. Like, I'm writing stories. Nobody's paying me to write these stories right now, but I'm writing them because I'm going to eventually try to make these stories. But you know, you got to kind of just stick with it, because part of it too is nobody wants to hire an artist that they don't know they're going to be able to finish the book. They don't know if they're going to be able to be around in a year or two, things like that. So you got to kind of show the dedication and show that you kind of are putting in the work. And so that's kind of like, especially that's what I'm looking for artists too, is I like to see if you've completed projects before. It's hard to kind of jump in with someone who hasn't completed a project, and definitely you can't just show a bunch of pinups, right? If you want to be an artist, show the panels. Panel work is going to get you way more work than any fantastic pinup or just full page spread. Just panel work and more panel work is what's going to get you jobs working for comic books.
Yeah, you got to show those sequentials, definitely. You can't go in there and not show interiors and then want to be hired as an interior artist. Right. And conversely, you know, if you want to get hired as a cover artist and all you show is interiors.
Right.
You know, right. you got to put out there what you're looking to get coming back to you. But that's something that drives me up the wall, though, when it comes to the discouraging of, oh, don't work for exposure, don't work for free, blah, blah, blah. Yes, you shouldn't just do that. First of all, you should never work for exposure, because if that's the mindset you have, the exposure that you're going to receive is never going to be beneficial to you. Usually people who work for exposure with that mindset are putting out things that they shouldn't want anyone to see. You know, at that, you're still most likely learning, which is what you should work for. You should work for experience. You should work to learn. You should work to network. You should work to grow. Because even if you're not doing it for someone else, you're going to definitely have to do it for yourself. You have to build that portfolio. You have to come up with your own story to show that you can do it, not just to the prospective client, but also just to yourself. A lot of artists, I don't think they know sometime, you know, you're sitting down there and task yourself with, all right, I got to do this 4-page story in 2 weeks. Do a quick, you know, anthology story. Do multiples of those. Do an 8-pager, do a 10-pager, then maybe do a 16 or a 20. Do a whole entire issue for something. You know, there's so many steps to it. I think there's sometimes this mindset that, like, oh, well, I like to draw, and I made this drawing that time, so how hard can making a comic book be? And then, you know, I've seen that. I'm sure you have too. You know, when you're looking for, if you ever put out the call that you're looking for someone, and then they send you something, and you're like, you're given the look of like, are you sure you're?
Is this like, what you want to do?
Yeah, you know, you don't know how to answer or handle the situation without coming across like you're being rude.
Right. Are you dabbling? Is this like, you know what I mean? Is this like, I understand exactly what you mean. It's like, I guess the example was like, I like to cook a lot. You know, I really enjoy it. People are like, oh, why don't you be a chef, right? Growing up, why don't you be a chef? Like, yeah, but I like to cook the things I like to cook. I couldn't be in the back putting mayonnaise. I hate mayonnaise. I can't put mayonnaise on a bunch of people's stuff. It would make me sick. Like, I can't, like, I don't want to put orders for other people, right? So, and I think a lot of artists are kind of, they like to draw, and then they're dabbling at doing it for a living, but you don't really want to do it. Just do
they like noodles. To draw what they want to draw, right, when they want to draw it.
Draw it, right.
You know, and there's it's multitudes of difference in that attitude and that mindset of what you're going to be doing and accomplishing, as opposed to when you're like, no, I'm, and that's the thing, is you can tell automatically. You got a really good eye. You got some great art at what you guys are publishing, and so I know that you know what you're talking about. And you even brought it on to a feedback forum one night with the great inks, and you're talking about, like, you're not so sure about the colors on this, and we had a great conversation about that. But there's a lot of art out there that, and I know you'll be able to relate to this, that when I've seen submissions come through, I don't need the 8 pages. I don't that I say that we need on the submission. I don't need even a page. Give me one panel. and I know if I want to see the next panel.
Right. No. Yeah. No. Yep. 100%. I know exactly. It doesn't take long, especially if you've looked at enough things. And I think that's kind of where it comes in. I think you had talked about this on a previous episode where, like, it's like, is it a hobby? I guess the way you can kind of tell, like, I'm just thinking of this now, is if you're obsessed about it. You know what I mean? That's the difference between if you can turn a hobby into a living for something that's very tedious and not, doesn't have immediate gratification. Is it an obsession? Can you not stop doing it? Right? Like, that's kind of like I can't stop making the comic books. I can't stop myself. Like, you know,
right? Yeah.
Like, even when I make
it's
money
like
from comics.
It's like asking you to stop breathing.
Right. Even the money I make from it, it just goes back into the comics. Like, it's not like I'm making any money from the comic books and even use it to pay bills or anything. It's just like, oh, I got money in. Oh, that's enough money for me to do this comic. You know what I mean? Like it's kind of like one of those things where it's just like, I can't stop writing the stories. And that's kind of how you have to be when you're doing anything that, honestly, it's a long climb, especially as an indie creator. Like, this is not the get rich quick scheme. It's almost the opposite. It's almost the go broke slow. Like, it's like the opposite. So, like, you really have to be down, and especially as an artist, because it takes a long time to do a page if you're really diligent about it. So you know what I mean? There's going to be times where you don't really want to do that background. Do the background. Do it. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, man. Madison, thank you so much. This was a great conversation, man. I really enjoyed it tonight. I'm glad we were able to have it. Thank you so much for being on here tonight.
Oh, thank you, Pete. Thanks for having me.
No problem. Before we part ways, where can they find you? Where do you want to send them?
You can check out my website, goldentreepublishing.com. We've got all our comics for sale. We actually have Eta, Sam Martel, issue 4 is on pre-order right now. There's a great trailer on the website you can check out if you want to know what the story's about. And you can find me at Golden Tree Publishing on Instagram, Twitter, and Facebook. And it's Golden Tree TV on YouTube, because we do some other things that's not just comic book related on our YouTube space. So yeah, you can check me out at any of those places.
Fantastic. Everybody in the chat, thank you guys so much for being here tonight. Your questions, your comments are always appreciated. If you enjoy this show or you enjoy any of the other shows that are on the channel, make sure to subscribe. We're getting YouTube being funky every now and then. It'll be like up and down. It's getting all weird. And if you enjoyed the show today, give it a thumbs up. If not, it's okay. You can give it a thumbs down too. I don't know why you would. It was a good conversation. But, you know, hopefully you guys are enjoying these. Really appreciate it. And thank you, Comics for Life. Thank you. But,
Thank you.
Madison, seriously, thanks a lot, man. This was a great conversation, and I'm glad we had it. And I wish you guys nothing but the best. You got some great-looking books over there. You guys can go sign up for Unicorn Melee 2. The link for that is in the description of the show, and I'm going to put the Golden Tree Publishing link in the description of the show in just a few minutes, too. But other than that, I'll be back tomorrow night. It's the return of Bill Mouse and Steve Stern. They were on here a few weeks ago, and their campaign is closing out in a few days. So they're going to be back, and we're going to continue the conversation that we left off with a few weeks ago. So yeah, I'll be back with them tomorrow night at 10 o'clock Eastern. I hope to see you guys then, too. And thank you, Kel Razor. Appreciate it. Thank you for being here. But until then, till tomorrow night, everybody, have a great night and an even better tomorrow. I'll see you guys soon. All the best.
Thanks, Pete.
No problem. Thank you, Madison.